record on this computer. Boom, perfect. So welcome everybody. We are in Trinidad, Colorado. I just want to, before we start, thank Leonard Friedman for, I got an email from him as I was planning the third virtual tour, and he's like, you got to check out Trinidad, and he shared the history. And so thank you, Leonard. There you are. Yeah, so how many people have heard of Trinidad, Colorado?
Never.
Oh, well, you will learn today. I'm just going to briefly read the description again, just one more time, about this. The town of Trinidad was founded in the 1860s as a stop on the mountain branch of the Santa Fe Trail, and has been home to Jews ever since. Founded in 1883, Temple Aaron is the oldest continually operating Jewish synagogue in Colorado and the Mountain West. Today, she is home to a resurgence of interest and open for a variety of cultural and religious events. Hear from members of the board about the history and present life of Temple Aaron. And we are joined today, and I believe everybody's here, Kim Grant, David London, Ron Rubin, Randy Rubin, Neil Paul, and Sherry Glickman, Net?
Connect.
Okay, yes, okay, perfect. So with that said, before I turn it over to the board, I do wanna share a quick video that I found online. It's recorded by it's not a professional video necessarily, but I love that it displays the, you know, small town feel. And then after we show this video, if the board would just introduce themselves, briefly introduce yourselves, and then we'll go from there. Okay, so I'm going to share my screen. One second. Boom.
What are you going to show us?
Okay. Share.
Does Kaiser supposed to call you back, Marsha?
All right, I'm also going to mute everybody right now.
That'd be great.
I could find my room.
Second.
What does that
say? Mojo. Share. I just need to mute it. Okay, there we go. All right, share screen. Okay, make this large. And then charge. There we go. If you'll just nod that you can hear it.
Well, it's all right, riding around in the breeze. It's all right, if you live the life you please. Well, it's all right, doing the best you can. Someone to tell you everything. Sit around and wonder what tomorrow will bring. Maybe a damn thing. Well, it's all right, even if they say you're wrong. Well, it's all right, sometimes you gotta be strong. Well, it's all right, as long as you got somewhere to lay. Well, it's somewhere down the road away, you'll think of me and wonder where I am these days. Maybe somewhere down the road when somebody plays purple haze. Well, it's all right, even when push comes to shove. Well, it's all right, if you got someone to love. Well, it's alright, everything will work out fine. Well, it's alright, we're going to the end of the line. Don't have to be ashamed of the car I drive. I'm just glad to be here, happy to feel that. if you're by my side, I'm satisfied. Well, it's all right, even if you're old and gray. Well, it's all right, you still got something to say. Well, it's all right, remember to live and live. Well, it's all right, the best you can do is forgive. Well, it's
share. There you go. I love that video and that small town feeling to see the architecture too and the characters. So if the board members could please unmute themselves and introduce themselves, that would be great.
I'm Ron Rubin, the younger brother of Randy Rubin, who is also a board member. I grew up in Raton, New Mexico. And we're the two last, I guess, original members of Temple Aaron.
No, because you're not sharing your screen.
Who are still on the board and trying to restore it.
Okay.
Don't share right now.
I want to try to share.
Okay, Neil, do you both want to go ahead and introduce yourselves?
Sure. Can you see the screen though, the PowerPoint?
I would hold off on sharing until all the board members go around. So
okay,
yeah,
I was just going to show a picture of the board. That's fine. So Sherry, if you want to introduce yourself.
Hi there, I'm Sherry Connect. I'm the newest board member.
Neil Paul, I'll kind of get into it as we get started. David, are you around?
Yeah, hi, David London from Boulder, Colorado.
Great.
Hello everyone, this is Kim Grant. I live in Denver. I'm originally from Kansas. And I work for Colorado Preservation, Inc.
I'm Randy Rubin. I actually live in Raton, New Mexico, which is about 19 miles south of Trinidad, and visit Temple Aaron frequently, checking on things. And as Ron said, my brother, we're, I guess, the two people that are standing from the original congregation, or our congregation time, I should say, not original.
Mm-hmm. Is that everybody?
Mm-hmm. I believe so.
Yep.
All right, so let's turn it over to you.
Is it sharing now?
You have to hit share screen.
I thought I had that.
No.
Which one is one?
Now you pick the PowerPoint.
Okay, I'm hoping.
There you go.
Okay, now let me just get, how do I get rid of this bar again? Sorry guys, start from the beginning. And there we go. All right. Well, thank you, Leo. We're really honored to be part of this. Real pleased. My involvement with the temple is much more recent. Randy and Ron will get into much more detail. I shouldn't even necessarily be starting this, but just as an intro, I became involved in 2016. I used to sit on the Denver B'nai B'rith board. I happened to hear about Temple Aaron, that's me. I happened to hear about Temple Aaron being up for sale a few years back on Colorado Public Radio, and it was kind of a kick in the gut. Later on, David London, another board member you'll be hearing from, brought it to the B'nai B'rith board's attention. That's when I first got involved with it. But just to give you a little quick summary, if you're not familiar with Trinidad, Colorado, it's basically in the center between, halfway between Santa Fe, New Mexico, and Denver, Colorado. Actually has a Tesla charging station, so there. When I first when I first heard about Trinidad, honestly, Trinidad, Colorado came to my ears back in the 70s for a whole different reason. Some of you might relate. We used to actually have a member of our congregation of Temple Aaron, Stanley Biber, who was the leading sex change or sex reassignment surgeon in the United States, possibly one of the leading in the world. And I heard about Trinidad, Colorado as a, you know, capital for sex changes. And then 40 years later, came across to get involved with the temple. So this sign was up when I first stepped foot on the property. After touring it, well, this is another little caption about small town Colorado and small town USA. They have these really festive events that go through Trinidad periodically. It's a really fun town, good culture, very open. They've been very inclusive, different peoples from, you know, many years back. Again, when I came up and entered the building, it just felt like something I wanted to be a part of. Through over the last few years, even through this cornerstone, you can see these are the original trustees. Two of the Jaffa brothers, Sam Jaffa was the mayor of Trinidad, first mayor of Trinidad, and his brother Jaffa was the first mayor, I think Kim could correct me, I believe of Albuquerque, New Mexico. So they made an early impression in the region. Again, a beautiful building. We'll get more into the details of it architecturally. But my involvement was just the fact that this building, in order for it to continue on for another generation, needs to be cared for. The town itself really does not have too many Jews at all. There's no actual congregation. It's more of an actual temple with a virtual congregation. On the left, you see the original boiler. On the right, you see the new boiler. Well, the new one needs replaced as well. It's a 131-year-old building. There's some work that needs done. We're working on an endowment. We really want to do everything possible to keep the doors open for the next generation. And who knows, Jews may start to populate Trinidad once again in that region. These four young ladies were joined by our efforts with Temple Aaron. These four actually belong to two of the people that you saw on the cornerstone, to the Jaffas. So they're descendants of the original builders of Temple Aaron back 131 years ago. And neither of these four women have ever met one another. So it's just kind of fun to bring people together through this whole process. Let me try to, what's going on here? Why is this not? Hang on a second. Somehow it. Let me see if I can get down real quick. Sorry, guys. Okay. Well, you know what? I'm going to back off because the rest of the board can really give you a lot more information. We're, again, in need for whatever sort of support, financial, personal, spiritual support possible. And do keep in mind, Trinidad is a great little community, and there are even a number of investors looking into the town of Trinidad. So I'll hand it over to Randy and Ron.
Randy, do you want to start with the early history of Temple Aaron?
Yes. I'm Randy Rubin. I'm the fellow that lives in Raton, New Mexico. And if you look on your maps, you'll see the border between New Mexico and Colorado. I live towards the eastern side of New Mexico and the eastern side of Colorado. As mentioned, Ron and I have been going there since the early 50s. We were both bar mitzvahed there. And the temple was founded, or the roots of it became, I guess, more pronounced in the 1860s, 1870s, as the Santa Fe Trail progressed and Trinidad became a trading center. And the last major town before the push on the Santa Fe Trail, went over Raton Pass, and then about 170 miles into Santa Fe. And the town sprang up due to several reasons: a confluence of water and natural resources, grazing, and Jews followed the Santa Fe Trail, opened up mercantile stores, and there were two names on the cornerstone whose relatives went on into the 70s, the 1970s, and even the 80s, Sanders and Gottlieb, and another name, Moses, and they had stores. They reached a critical point, had 19 men who started a B'nai B'rith Lodge later on, but started having, I guess, services. And in 1883, they reached a critical point of saying, we need a temple, and started the effort to build a temple. It was consummated in around 1889, and Temple Aaron is a result of that. What's very interesting about our temple, it's unchanged. And what you're looking at and seeing, with obvious exceptions, I think the seating, those seats that you can see now, have been redone in blue. That covering of the pulpit, that's new. But for the most part, if someone were to drop back into Trinidad from 1901, they could look at that building and realize it's the same as it was then. We had a short stint for a rabbi from about 1888, 1887. His name is somewhat lost to antiquity. Rabbi Freudenthal showed up. He was a German immigrant, reform rabbi, and the initial services were held in German and in English. And part of the structure of the temple, I should say the architecture, goes back to that. And he served the temple from 1889 to 1916. And upon his death, there was never again another rabbi in residence. He had two sons. One of them endowed the temple for a large sum of money at the time in around 1940. And his endowment is what kept the temple going till 2008, and everybody knows what happened then, and the funds started dwindling, and it forced our family, which was my mother, my brother, and myself, to think there was no other recourse but to put the building up for sale. It was a very, very emotional, tough thing to put that sign up that said temple for sale, and something that we did that, I don't know what the right word is, but it was with a great deal of regret. We sold two of the Torahs, thinking we could postpone what we thought at the time was the inevitable of having to literally shutter the temple. And that started happening about 4 or 5 years ago. Well, let me rephrase that. David Neal came on board and provided great energy, foresight, and vision about saving the temple, and that's where we are today. Kim came on board, which has been a lifesaver, as well as Sherry. And we've managed to hold on, although we're in dire need of some major renovation, the roof, the boiler, the window casings. But what you're looking at is virtually what was there in 1889. It was built for the princely sum of $12,500. Wow. And that picture, you're seeing pictures of, at that time, the early 50s, that was the congregation. And it has dwindled since. There's one Jewish fellow who lives in Trinidad now. There's two or three of us in the Raton area, and the rest come from afar. Boulder, Denver, Colorado Springs, Pueblo, Colorado. So we've dwindled mightily. The Jews of Trinidad over the years, not so much recently, have made great impacts in that community. And a person whose name must be mentioned is a woman by the name of B. Sanders. And she was a lay rabbi, received a doctorate of letters from the Hebrew Union College, as did her husband. And the Hebrew Union College also must be mentioned. Over the years, we had eminent rabbis, as well as students, come out from Cincinnati to lead High Holy Day services. One of the most eminent rabbis that have served the Hebrew Union College was Jacob Rader Marcus, and he came out for, I think, 18 years. Correct me if I'm wrong, Ron. But they named the Jewish Union Archives, the Hebrew Union Archives, after him. And we've enjoyed great intellectual rabbis. I guess that's well said. And it's been quite a ride in recent years. And fortunately, due to Sherry, Kim, David, and Neil, I feel we're on a good road of keeping the temple Jewish. We had many offers to sell it for various things, some of which were a wedding center. Another one was the district attorney's office. Quite interesting proposals. And fortunately, we're keeping it Jewish. I'm trying to think if there's anything I've overlooked that anybody else wants to jump in on, but I'm sure you'll hear much more. And I'll turn this over to someone else to go forward. Thank you for being with us, by the way. I'm assuming from LA and Honolulu. So
Tampa, welcome. Florida, and other places. New Mexico, I just saw someone said they're from... Oh, and someone's watching from Jerusalem.
Ah.
Very cool. Wow.
Well, I see some Albuquerque folks. Hello, Albuquerque. I know there's two. And welcome. The Albuquerque folks have been to Raton and Trinidad, and that's grand. Thank you. L'chaim.
Thanks, Randy. Ron, did you have anything you want to jump in?
Yes, I wanted to talk about our growing up years in the 1950s, sure. Because that's about as recent as we can, or about as far back as we can go. If our mother were still alive, who died 2 years ago, that's a picture of her with both of us. She can tell you the history almost from the very beginning, even though she wasn't even born then. She had this incredible mind for history and for people. My brother was born in 1949. I was born in 1951. And when we were young, we had a Sunday school, and we had the Sunday school for about 5 years, and my brother and I would travel from Raton over Raton Pass, which is about 20 miles, to Trinidad on Sundays, and go to Sunday school with the other children. Probably there were 8 to 12 of us, I would say, at the most, and we would have Purim parties and Hanukkah parties, and it was fun. It was the connection for at least our family from Raton. And when we were young, we were the only Jewish family in Raton. Raton is a city of about, at that time, I think it was 7,000 or 8,000 people. Maybe now it's about 6,000. Trinidad was about the same size. And so we grew up being the only Jewish family. And we would get dressed up on these odd days to all the other kids in school. And they'd say, why are you wearing a suit? And I'd say, oh, you know, our parents were in the clothing business that my grandfather started in 1915. And I'd say, my parents just want us to wear a suit, because I didn't want to tell them about how different we were. No one really knew we were Jewish. I just didn't feel it was appropriate. And then we would go to high holiday services or whatever. So we had Sunday school. And then our parents, who felt it very important that we maintain our Jewishness, and there was this congregation in Trinidad. Many of the people you see in that picture, I think they've all passed away, but we grew up with many of them. And almost all of them lived to be very, very old. One of the gentlemen lived to be 101, and we just had a wonderful congregation. I'll tell you more about the people we grew up with. So our parents wanted us to have a bar mitzvah. So my brother in 1962 traveled to Albuquerque, New Mexico, as did I 2 years later, 1964. We studied with a rabbi in Albuquerque and then came back and had our bar mitzvahs those same years in September. And that was a huge effort on my parents' parts. We lived with our aunt and uncle in Albuquerque, and every day went to the rabbi's house, and we learned Hebrew as much as we could, some Torah portions, and we learned our Torah portions and recited them in Hebrew. I might say from the very first day that Temple Aaron was established, it was a Reform congregation. And yes, it was Rabbi Scheinling in Albuquerque who instructed us. But it was always a Reformed temple. And it was one of the early Reformed temples, because the Hebrew Union College, the Union of American Hebrew Congregations, was started by Isaac Mayer Wise in the 1870s and 1880s. Well, Trinidad's congregation was founded in 1883, and it was always a Reform congregation, which I think is important to note. Women were equal. We always had women on the pulpit, and it was Reform congregation from the very beginning. Let's see, so we had our bar mitzvahs there, and then mine was in 1964. Mine was the last bar mitzvah, or b'nai mitzvah, for 27 years. The next one was my brother's daughter, whose name is Nina, and she had hers there 27 years later, in 1991. We had wonderful role models in Trinidad. The Jewish people that we grew up with were all mainly older Jewish couples who lived in Trinidad. One couple had a shoe store. Their name was Louis and Yetta Seidel. One had a larger store by the name of Albert Moses. One had an insurance company, Leo Gottlieb, and he's the one that lived to be about 101 or 102. He shook the hands of, I think, 10 presidents, and he was the first Rotarian in Colorado to be in Rotary for 75 years. They all lived very long. B. Sanders, who my brother mentioned, lived to be, I think, 87. And as Randy said, we had wonderful rabbis there, some very illustrious ones. The one that he mentioned, well, I guess I can show this. It's Jacob Rader.
Yeah, there you go.
Okay, Jacob Rader Marcus. And he was the founder of the American Jewish Archives. I might tell you, he was the first trained historian of the Jewish people born in America and the first to devote himself fully to the scholarly study of America's Jews. And he was our rabbi for many, many years. If you mention Jacob Rader Marcus to almost any Reformed Jew who is familiar with the UAHC or the anything Reform, Jacob Marcus is really, really highly revered. Another rabbi who used to come and minister to us was Rabbi Alexander Schindler. And he was the rabbi for the second president of the Union of American Hebrew Congregations for, I think over 20 years also. And he came to Trinidad. We had a lot of rabbis who primarily came to the East for our high holidays and for Pesach as well. Here's a book by Jacob Rader Marcus on the rise and fall of the German Jews. He wrote many, many books as well. Let's see. We had We also have, of course, a cemetery in Trinidad, the Temple Aaron Cemetery, and that was established around the same time that the synagogue was established. Of course, cemeteries are the first thing to be established, and almost all of the people whom we've mentioned are buried there, including the Freudenthals. There's a picture of it, Congregation Aaron. There are the Freudenthal headstones, the first rabbi, and then one of the first families there as well. We grew up with probably one person who is pretty well known in the country. I don't know if any of you have heard of him, but his name was Dr. Stanley Biber. And he was there's his headstone. He was the preeminent sex change or reassignment surgeon for people who felt that they weren't in the right body sexually. And he performed probably 8,000 or 10,000 sexual reassignments. We grew up with him and his children in Trinidad as well. And I've just been recently in touch with his son, who is my age. I left in 1980 to move to Colorado Springs, but my brother has lived there his whole life. As Randy mentioned, B. Sanders was our lay leader until our mom took over in 1987. And our mother was the person who helped run the congregation for around 24 years. I guess now I could turn it over to who is next on the board.
Let's just let me pull it up. Sorry, guys.
I think it's, I am.
David? No, it's Kim. Sorry. Let me just fast forward. Apologize, folks. There we go. Kim,
you're on. Okay.
All right. Hello, everybody. I work for an organization called Colorado Preservation, Inc., and we're a statewide nonprofit organization that works with communities all over Colorado to save important historic sites. And I've lived in Denver for 30 years, and there was a woman in my shul who about 40 years ago wrote a couple articles that were published in the Western Jewish Historical Quarterly, which was actually published right in the Mid-Wilshire District of Los Angeles for many years. And she wrote some articles about Trinidad and Temple Aaron, and that kind of piqued my interest. But I have a long-standing interest in architecture and preservation. And as a Jewish person, this place has special resonance for me. So I'll talk real quickly about the architectural style and features of this unique building. It's considered exotic revival style, which was very popular in the early part of, in the late 19th and early 20th century. There are other exotic revival style synagogues around the country, but it's very rare to find one west of the Mississippi. And some of the features include, if you look at the front facade, first of all, you have to envision, as was kind of shown in the video, this building sits way high up on a hill with a spectacular view of the town and the Purgatory River Valley. And it has some interesting features. If you look closely, it has two towers. The tower on the left is called a pyramidal tower, and it has a pressed metal pyramid-shaped roof. The tower on the right is an onion dome, like a Turkish onion dome tower that you might find in the Ottoman Empire or that part of the world. And then in the center of the building, there's a close-up of the onion dome. And this is fabricated, you know, keep in mind, in 1889, metal. And there's about a 2-foot hole that's missing from it right now because of a windstorm. And just to the left of that, these elements, there's a close-up of what I'm talking about. These look very much like a Torah scroll or the finials of a Torah scroll. And they're basically minarets, which again comes from that sort of exotic revival style. The top and bottom portion are stone, and then the middle portion is wrapped metal. So it kind of looks like a Torah scroll. The architect was a guy by the name of Isaac Hamilton Rapp, and he and his brother operated a firm. They were called the Rapp Brothers for a while. His brother worked mainly out of Boston, but Isaac Hamilton made his way west, and this guy was a really prolific architect. He designed over 80 buildings in Trinidad alone and worked on hundreds of buildings in the region, and later was credited with creating what's called the Santa Fe style. So if you've ever been to Santa Fe, New Mexico, you know there's a lot of adobe and stucco buildings, and they have this Spanish colonial look to them. And Rapp was really kind of the inventor of that style. But one of his, and he designed several extraordinary buildings in Trinidad, including some other religious buildings. This is a shot of the interior and the beautiful sanctuary. If you move on a little bit, I'll kind of wrap things up in my part. But as Randy mentioned and Ron mentioned, it's pretty well intact. And we are working now to seek a national landmark nomination for the temple, because not only is it architecturally distinctive, but the story of the westward migration of Jews to places like Trinidad is a story that can be illustrated here as an example to, you know, how people came across the country and settled and built communities. And certainly Temple Aaron's founders were some of the pillars of the community of Trinidad. So it's a unique building architecturally. We're in the process of trying to get some roof work done. that particular photo right there shows the some of the issues going on with the roof. The lower roof in particular over the porch is in really rough shape. And like all buildings of this age, there are immense needs. But I would like to emphasize, and maybe David will talk about this as well, is that what we're trying to do is not just save the building, but kind of try to create a new regional model of a virtual congregation. So every time we have events at the temple, we have people there from everywhere from Boulder to Albuquerque. We've had people from Israel and from New York City and so on and so forth. And so it's a very different notion of a congregation because there's not a real critical mass of Jews in Trinidad today. But there's a lot of interest in the project and we're really happy to share it with you today. Thank you.
May I say one thing? I don't know if you're finished, Kim, or not, but this is rather important historically as well. The rabbi who was there for those many years, Rabbi Freudenthal, the Rapp brothers, who Kim mentioned as the architects and had so many, yes, there's Isaac Hamilton Rapp, who designed the building and so many buildings in Trinidad and is very highly respected as an architect, also designed Zion's Lutheran Church there. And the rabbi, our rabbi, who spoke fluent German, and the Lutherans did not have a minister at the time, and he would go to their church and conduct services in German to the Lutherans. And so we've maintained a rather close connection with them. And lately, they've been very, very supportive of our temple. But those are two interesting facts about our rabbi ministering to a Lutheran congregation in German. Another sort of interesting fact, if I might say this, the Lutherans were looking for a minister for their church, and they found one after a long search to come to Trinidad, and they were going to have a welcoming and a grand opening, I guess, of the temple to their new minister, and they said, we'd like to invite the Jews of Temple Aaron, and he said, no, I will not allow that. I will not allow our congregation to have Jews here for my first meeting. And they, as quickly as they hired him, they fired him, and he never did serve, because the Zion Lutheran Church felt it was so important because of the connections between Temple Aaron and their church that we would be friends and we would maintain the cordiality that they had had before that.
Yeah, that's special. That's a great story, Ron. Appreciate that. That's we'll move on. Let David, if you want to jump in, I have some slides for you too.
Sure. So you know, as Neil started the presentation, in 2016, the building was put up for sale because Ron and Randy, the Rubin family, had sort of reached the end of their tether in their efforts, their valiant efforts to maintain the congregation and the building. And I'll say here, one of the best things in my involvement with the temple was the opportunity to meet Ron and Randy's mother, Catherine, who you've seen in a couple slides, but she just deserves.
I agree.
Ron and Randy are too modest. She was yes, an incredible matriarch of the temple. Absolutely. And getting to know her for a year and a half, almost 2 years before she passed away in 2018 was very special. So I live in Boulder, Colorado. I'm an attorney. I visited the outside of the temple one time. I'd never been inside. And as we've talked about, the temple was technically closed. There were no Rosh Hashanah services in the temple in 2016 for the first time since the 1880s. My aunt, who also lives here in Boulder, cut out a front page article in the Denver Post that talked about the temple's closing, and she sent it to me. And I read the article and I was like, this is such a crying shame. I have to, you know, whatever I can do to stop this, I'm going to try and do it. And that's, I'm not, it's kind of not my real nature most of the time, but for whatever reason, this really spoke to me. So Randy Rubin was mentioned in the article, and through connections I have, I knew someone who knew Randy. I'll just leave it at that. So I got in touch with that lady and I said, please give me Randy Rubin's contact information. She did. Her name is Sharon Niederman. I don't know if she's on. She's a very active Jewish person in northern New Mexico. So I cold called Randy Rubin and just said, you don't know me, but my name is David London. I live in Boulder. And if there's anything I can do to stop the closing of the temple and stop the sale, you know, I'm with you. And Randy and I had a great chat. And slowly but surely, we developed this this small coalition of people. As Neil mentioned at the beginning of our talk, there was some original involvement with the Denver B'nai B'rith group, and that's how Neil and I met. That ultimately didn't pan out, but slowly but surely, we developed a board. We met with Ron and Randy. And then Kim and Sherry came on a little bit later. And little by little, since late 2016, we've gotten the building some stability. We've raised over $100,000 since that time, which has been great to give some breathing space and cover operating expenses and things of that nature, as Kim and others have talked about. The building needs substantial repairs. That those funds, you know, don't begin to approach the need for. We're applying for grants and so forth. We've had some success reaching out to the philanthropic community in Denver to give us donations in the $100,000 range. And so our mission, and we've become, the six of us have become very good friends over the last few years, is to preserve the building and to create what we've called a virtual congregation of people when we have events at Temple. And prior to the COVID crisis, we had a very nice programming of, which Sherry will talk about more in a minute, you know, several events per year, Passover Seders, Rosh Hashanah speakers, 130th anniversary gala last summer that we want to continue once it's safe to meet again. And I guess one of my big takeaways from my experience with the temple, and not to be negative in any way, but this has been a grassroots effort. You know, there was no major Jewish organization, if you will, that stepped in to save the temple. Just a bunch of people did it. We've had some success reaching out to bigger groups, but if it hadn't been for, you know, a bunch of little people, if you will, the temple would have been sold. So when you see something that speaks to you, just jump in and hopefully you can turn things around. But there's no big brother out there, you know, to do this type of work. It's all done at the grassroots level.
We're still waiting for that big brother or sister to show up.
May I say one more thing? I don't know if you can even read this, and Leah, I don't know if it'll show up, but this was from the Intermountain Jewish News that was from September 7th of 2018, the Intermountain Jewish News is a very large Jewish newspaper that is published in Denver, Colorado, that goes really all over the world, but primarily in the Intermountain West. But it says, historic synagogue saved for now. The Rubin family, a Colorado nonprofit, and the city of Trinidad joined forces. And then it says community rallies to the rescue. And there are pictures of Neil and me and Kim Grant and my mother. And so this was really big news when we saved the temple from being sold at that time.
Let me add one more interesting tidbit. I don't know, this is a Jewish audience, so maybe there's a few lawyers listening, and I'm an attorney. One of the things that we had to do as part of the temple's resurrection and restructuring, the ownership of the temple had not changed since 1889, when the land was deeded to quote unquote Congregation Aaron, Colorado Religious Association. Well, there were no records at Colorado Secretary of State of that entity existing. And in order to, you know, bring things up into the 21st century and be, have a platform to raise money through ownership, we formed a brand new Colorado nonprofit organization or corporation named Temple Aaron of Trinidad, Colorado. And we worked with the local title company to have Ron and Randy and their mother sign the deed on behalf of this literally 1880s unincorporated religious association to this new up-to-date Colorado nonprofit corporation. And my suspicion is that a lot of old temples have the same very outdated ownership structure that we had to remedy as part of our efforts.
Yeah, that was an interesting process. Thanks for helping.
Yes.
Thank you for helping through that, David. That was a,
Are there any other presenters or is it time to open it up?
Sherry was going to present real quick.
Oh yes, Sherry. Okay, yes. And then we'll, if she's the last one, we'll go from there and we'll open it up for questions.
Okay, great.
Yep, I'm the last. So as I said before, I'm the newest board member. I came on because, you know, Ron and Randy and Kim and Neil and David were all working as hard as they could kind of, you know, in the background, but it became apparent that we needed to have some communications and organization happening to, you know, work with other people. And so that's how I sort of jumped into the picture to help with the website and communications. And so early in the process, you know, aside from just saving the exterior or just saving the building as a structure, we really wanted to bring life back to the temple in terms of having events to whatever degree we could. And so we started having Passover services, Rosh Hashanah services, and some other events, some educational events. This is obviously a photo from Passover Seder in 2018. We started fundraising, both in Trinidad and also in the Denver metro area. In 2018, we did a tour of abandoned synagogues in Denver. Phil Goodstein Tyler is a really interesting historian, and he led that tour. We've had a lot of events. We could not hold events at the temple during the winter because there's no heat right now. That's one of the major things that has to get fixed. We need a boiler. So we're able to hold events there in the spring, summer, and fall, but not the winter. This slide shows just a few pictures from a really big event we had last year in the summer. We celebrated the temple's 130th birthday. That was a really special weekend event. One of the things we did was, before the event, we reached out to the community to ask, you know, who among you are descendants of the original founders of the temple? And we were really, really pleasantly surprised at how many people came forward, and we were able to honor those descendants at part of the celebration. This picture up at the podium with people speaking is part of a ceremony we had where we dedicated the historic marker that got erected outside during that ceremony. That's this. David played a big role in getting that done with Jerry Klinger. So that was dedicated at the 130th anniversary. I'm just gonna share a few other pictures. We don't have a regular rabbi. We don't have regular office hours. We're not open regular, you know, every Friday night or anything. But, you know, as a few of the other people have said, people come from all over to our events. It kind of surprised us, but it's sort of been this organic growth over the last few years of a really wonderful congregation of people. People come, like David said, I think from, you know, Boulder, Denver, Colorado Springs, Albuquerque, Santa Fe, as well as sometimes other places, California, you know, New York, other places. Yeah, and it's really amazing. And of course, there are some people still in the Trinidad Raton area who had been members of the congregation before and are glad to just, you know, see the temple sort of being revived. We have some really amazing volunteers. So I was just going to say, you know, we don't have a regular rabbi, but for our events, we have asked various rabbis to participate, and they've been wonderful. So in this particular service, we had three rabbis come and participate. Rabbi Rob Lenick is in the middle. He's the executive director of the Jewish Federation of New Mexico. We had Rabbi Bernie Gerson from Denver, and Rabbi Shimon Moak, who is a little bit obscured by the flowers, also from the Denver area. This is just an interior shot at one of the events during the gala celebration. We've had events in Denver as well. Some of them have been educational, fundraising. In February of this year, we had a fundraiser at the Mercury Cafe. A couple of great musicians played and, you know, helped raise some money for the temple. And that was Buckstein and Clay Kirkland who played. This slide is about an event to come. I don't know if any of you are familiar with this film. It's called Children of the Inquisition. It is a really incredible film about the history of what happened to the Jews who were forced to convert and flee during the time of the Inquisition. It's a really remarkable film. It fills in a part of the Jewish history that is sort of gaining a lot of traction and interest right now.
It's very relevant to the location, Trinidad.
Yeah, it's very relevant to Trinidad, because there are many Hispanic families who have that heritage. So we plan to show that. We do have, guys, not right now. We have, we're planning and hoping to have in-person events later this summer and fall. Given the situation, we're not quite sure of the schedule of when the state is going to open, so it's possible we may have to do some online showings. That remains to be seen. We have a Facebook page. If anybody's interested in following us and seeing what else we're doing, please follow along. This is just a little montage of a few pictures of our wonderful community. Did you want to say something else?
No, it's just
And in closing, I'm just kind of reiterating, you know, right now we're working hard to create an endowment and hopefully save Temple Aaron in perpetuity. And once we have heat, we'll be able to have events year round instead of just three seasons. To all of you who are on the call, we would love for you to stop by. So if you're coming through Colorado and would like to tour it in person, reach out to us. Let us know. We're happy to do it.
There's some great, great bed and breakfasts in Trinidad, great places to stay. It's a booming, bustling little economic town for a small mountain town. It's definitely worth your trip.
Thanks for including us in this event.
Wow, thank you for putting together that comprehensive PowerPoint. That must have taken a significant amount of time. That was wonderful. Thank you so much to all the board members. I mean, the way you coalesced, came together and put this wonderful presentation together. So why don't we open it up for questions?
May I say one thing, please, Leah?
Sure.
This is Randy Rubin. It was mentioned, if you're in Denver, Colorado Springs, many people travel to Albuquerque and Santa Fe. We're about 2 hours north of Santa Fe, and I'm more than happy, as Sherry said, to give tours. I'm 19 miles away. It's great fun for me, I must say. I've met some interesting people. And if someone wants to tour and to see the temple and get a feel for what an 1889 synagogue is like, more than happy to take people through. It's a grand structure. I just want to make that clear, whether you're in New Mexico or Colorado. Thank you.
Wonderful. All right. So please, if you have a question, raise your hand or even click the button, the raise the hand feature, because I can't see everybody. So feel free to raise your hand. Any questions?
Robbie Bear has a question.
Esther?
When you have events, are there a lot of young people that come? Because people are traveling to come to see the events, do young people come as well?
I would say not too many, but some families do bring their children, for sure. I would say the majority of people are older. But yes, some younger people do come, certainly, with their parents.
We have had a lot of young adults show up from New Mexico and Boulder and places like that. So each time we have an event, there's always some new faces that show up. It's really exciting.
Rosanna.
So I wanted to know right now, what's the amount of Jewish people in Trinidad? How many Jews in Trinidad? Do you know? Anybody know?
Three, four, five, six, probably not 10.
Yeah, maybe
not enough for a minion.
Yeah.
At one time, though, there were over 1,000 Jews in Trinidad, shortly after the turn of the century.
The sanctuary upstairs in the temple seats 200 or 250 people.
Wow.
So, yes, there were one time over 300 members in the temple.
Did someone say 1,000 Jews? There were 100 Jews.
You sure?
I thought the temple... But it seats 200, right? Mm-hmm. 250?
Yes, that's right. But I think it was around, at maximum, it was 100 to 100, maybe 25 at that time.
Okay.
If I may jump in, this is Randy Rubin. There's one Jewish fellow in Trinidad. He's a chiropractor, a member of our congregation. If there are other Jews, they have not made themselves known to us. There have been things said that this person's Jewish or that person's Jewish. For whatever reason, they haven't made themselves known. We try and advertise that we do hold events, and I guess that's the same as any place else in the world for that matter. But it's slim pickings at this point in terms of people who show up from the immediate surroundings.
Okay. John Rivers, if you'll unmute yourself.
I want to ask Randy or Ron or David, have you done anything with the archive material that's located in the basement?
David, this is Randy. Now I recognize you all because you've been there.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Both of you. Yes, I know who you are now. Thanks for asking that question. Last year, they were brought up out of the basement and put into the foyer. We did have someone go through them, and there's a lot of superfluous things that are just not relevant, and there are some other things, but no, we haven't gone through them book by book, if that's what you're asking. David or Neil or someone else may want to comment on that, but they are out of the basement, which was a big deal.
Yes.
We inhaled a lot of dust
doing yes.
that job, but yeah, at least they're out of the musty basement and in the foyer as well.
So Dale, if you'll unmute yourself.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi, shalom from Jerusalem, first of all. It's nice, hey. nice
shalom.
That you guys are doing this. I think I mentioned in comments that my mother was born and raised in Trinidad. But anyway, my question is, if someone, because I know my mom has some things back from, you know, the old Trinidad days, you know, from her mother and her mother's mother. But is there a way that she can or that I can get some things from her and maybe if they're significant enough, that can be donated to the archives?
Absolutely. Sure. You can reach any one of us or just go through the website, info@templearon.org. Sherry deals with that directly, so you can reach out to any one of us. Or,
and then also, my second question is, especially for the fella in Raton, I'm just curious how folks, Jews right now, how they're experiencing things like the Seder and that sort of thing. Do they drive up to Denver, or is there something that the few in the community get together and do something with families?
Until this year, this is Randy Rubin. I'm the fellow that lives in Raton. Until this year, we've had Seders at the synagogue. And obviously, under the circumstances, we did not. So this year, you mentioned what I do in Raton. I did a virtual Seder from Albuquerque that was delightful. But we didn't have one, obviously, face-to-face. But we've had delightful Seders the last 2 or 3 years. I want to emphasize again, if I may, Randy Rubin saying this. David, Neil, Sherry, Kim, and my brother have brought boundless energy. And had they not done this, that building would be a district attorney's office, a B&B, or abandoned. May I ask you also, what is your mother's name, or what was her maiden name, or what was her married name?
Berger was her Jewish name, and then her another family name was Pacheco, which goes back to the Inquisition, Spanish, Spain, and that sort of thing. Her father wasn't Jewish. His ancestry was from Italy.
Did you say Berger?
Berger.
Thank you.
Okay, so we have time for about 3 more questions. We'll hear from Hannah and Marshall, then we'll hear from Paul and Zwi. Got to unmute yourself. Oh, and then Leonard. We're concluding with Leonard Friedman.
You said that it was a booming, bustling economy. What kind of work do people do in Trinidad?
I can jump in for a while. This is Randy Rubin again. Mm-hmm. Trinidad, as in Raton, has an abundance of coal. And the coal, it's called the Raton Basin, frankly. And the Raton Basin extends from about Raton to about 60 miles north to Walsenburg. And the hills, mountains around here are riddled with coal. And during the early part of the 1900s, there were many coal mines. As a matter of fact, Mother Jones marched here in Trinidad. There was labor strife. It was a railroad crossing point for the Santa Fe Trail, after the Santa Fe Trail, of course. But the Raton Pass was a major obstacle for trains and locomotives. And it just became a hub for ranching, coal mining. And that was coal mining really powered Trinidad as well as Raton.
And trade for the Raton Pass. There was Raton Pass is rather historic. There's a gentleman who was named Dick Wooten who was at the top of the pass. He had a ranch, and he would charge people to go over the pass, except for Native Americans. And that's part of the history of Trinidad and Raton as well. On the Santa Fe Trail, Raton Pass, when the Santa Fe Railroad was established, is the highest point between Los Angeles and Chicago to go over Raton Pass. So railroading was also a huge thing because they had to add more engines to get over Raton Pass.
And what is the economy now? What do people do there now?
So, as we've sort of been alluding, it's been a kind of a boom and bust town ever since the 1870s. It's been coal, it's been Dr. Biber's sex reassignment practice that we touched on. Right today, the two big things in Trinidad are the arts. We showed some photos of different festivals that happen in Trinidad, and also cannabis. There are more pot shops in Trinidad per capita than almost anywhere else, and that's cannabis. Largely because the surrounding states have not yet legalized marijuana.
Wow.
So that's big in Trinidad right now. One more thing about the location, we've welcomed visits, as we've been saying, but Trinidad is literally right off the highway, Interstate 25, and the temple, you can see the temple from the highway if you know where to look, and it's literally 5 minutes from the interstate, so it's very accessible and easy to find.
Okay.
So I'm going to mention what I'm going to do is, I know some other people had questions, Sue Motley, Lori Copland will add you guys, but before I do that, I'm going to just take, I'm going to announce tomorrow's program first. Tomorrow at 3 p.m. California time, 6 p.m. Florida time, we're going to be heading to Detroit. And we have a wonderful lineup of people. We have a rabbi from the largest Reform synagogue in the world, Temple Israel. We're having a rabbi from the local conservative synagogue. I'm not entirely sure how many conservative synagogues are. He'll be welcoming us. We're going to have Joel Tauber, who's a philanthropist and literally a leader of like every Jewish organization out there. We're going to have Arthur Horwitz, who is the executive director and founder of the Detroit Jewish News. And we're going to have someone from the Federation. So we hope you join us tomorrow. And with that said, let's go ahead and get back to the questions. We'll have Paul, Zwi, Leonard, Sue, and Lori. And I'm not sure if, oh, and also Dahlia asked Randy to please look at your private chat. So, all right, so let's start with Paul.
Yeah, hi, I'm Paul. I live in Los Angeles and I've been a longtime member of Temple Beth Am. First, I'd just like to thank you for allowing us into your community to learn of this very unique community with such a small amount of Jews, but seemingly very active. Just a simple question: do you, during our visits all over the country, we've come into cities where there's been a lot of interaction with the Christian community. Do you guys have any action, formal interaction with the Christian communities there?
Well, if I might. This is Ron, as you can see by my name. We have had that in the past. Between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, every year for many, many years, we had something called an interfaith tea. And that was on the Sunday between Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. And it was an outreach to all the Trinidad people to do something interfaith. And the rabbi who was there, who was the rabbi for the high holidays, would have this interfaith tea, and we attracted probably 50 to 100 people, and it was the time when a lot of non-Jews would come into the temple, sometimes for the first time, and could be there. As a formal outreach, we don't do that regularly, but whenever we hold educational or religious events, or musical events, or our 130th anniversary, the outside community and the Christian community is always welcome. Trinidad and Raton are probably 70 to 80% Catholic because of the Hispanics that are there, and also mining was huge for Eastern European families who are mainly Catholic, and a lot of Italians. So it's mainly Catholic, and then that's what we've done in the past.
Great. Zwi?
If I could just jump in real quick, if all those participating, if you'd like to be added to our mail-in list, we can keep you abreast of what's going on with the temple. Various events, you can, you know.
They can join virtually too, right?
Sure. Yes. Yeah. Yes, you can join virtually. We can take virtual donations as well as real ones. But we can all be a part of our community from your own comfort of your own living room.
I'm seeing that a lot of you have asked questions and put comments in the group chat, and I couldn't possibly type fast enough to answer a lot of you. There's some really good questions. If you would like us to answer more of these questions, you know, feel free to email info@templearon.org, or we also have the website, the Facebook page. So get in touch with us one of those ways, and we're happy to answer your questions. I just don't know how to do it quickly because there are so many of us, and I know we're about out of time.
Sweet.
Sure, I answered a few of the chats.
Okay.
Great.
answered a few of the questions.
Thanks, David.
I just wanted to say there's the Society for Crypto-Jewish Studies, Crypto-Judaic Studies, and we were featured in at their last convention in Denver, even though our roots go back to mainly Northern European and German Jewry. It wasn't really with crypto Jews or the Jews from the Inquisition. Although if you get a chance to see that movie, Children of the Inquisition, you really should see it. It's remarkable. But we were featured in the society as one of the stops on the Santa Fe Trail for the Society for Crypto Jewish Studies. And they have a wonderful website as well.
Great. Zwi Resnick, did you have a question or?
Yes. I lived in Colorado for a number of years, and I have a connection through my wife's family to Leadville. And I was wondering if the experience of the Temple Israel Foundation and the renovation of their synagogue has been any guidance or informed you in any way? Or
well, we're all familiar. We all know Bill Korn, who's been working that, and he knows of us. We'd love to support them, and I think they equally us. I don't know that we're working hand in hand together. We're far enough physically apart.
Oh yeah.
But I think in spiritually, I think we're trying to support one another. And what Bill's done there is a great story. Mm-hmm. A little different. That temple was used in other ways, or for a while wasn't mm-hmm. even a synagogue. So.
Right.
This has been continuously a synagogue, but Bill Korn's done some real special things in Leadville. Also an interesting place to go visit.
Yeah.
Thanks for bringing that up.
Which can only be done in July or August.
Right. not if you have your skis with you, it could be done.
Well, that's true. Okay. Thank you.
Great skiing. Thank you.
Leonard.
Oh, yes. Letter.
I wasn't actually raising my hand, but if people want to know, I'm happy to tell the story again if people want to know how I heard about Trinidad.
Sure.
It's the condensed version. Sorry. I'm just trying to be mindful of time.
Okay, this will only take 20 minutes then. So I was driving cross country and I stopped in a small town in the northeast corner of New Mexico, Clayton, New Mexico, and discovered in town that the historical museum is in a museum called the Hertzstein Museum, and said, well, there must be a story there. And so I went inside and discovered that the town had two Jewish families, the Hertzsteins and the Isaacs. And there's a whole room dedicated to the Hertzsteins since they donated most of the money for the museum. And one of the exhibits there said that one of the children or grandchildren of the pioneers who came to Clayton had married a Christian woman, and his wife, the Christian wife, insisted that they go to church once a year and they go to synagogue once a year. And as it turned out, the closest synagogue to Clayton, New Mexico, was over 100 miles away in Trinidad, Colorado. And so when I got home, I got online to learn more about Trinidad. And this was in 2016, and discovered that the synagogue had just closed and the building was for sale. And it was rather, upsetting to learn all this stuff, the oldest synagogue in Colorado. But when I later logged on to see what was happening, discovered that, a resurrection of sorts was taking place. And really want to thank all you guys on the board for all the work you've done to do this. It certainly made me a lot happier, even though I'd never actually been to the synagogue or stopped in Trinidad, but I hope to do so someday.
So Leonard, thank you for that. And a request of everybody. People zoom in and out of their Jewish history, and we still do hear from time to time that, oh, I thought it was closed, or oh, I thought it was for sale. And it's just because people have checked in a while. So if you do hear that, please correct them. Please send them to our website and please let them know that we're still alive and kicking, because people's knowledge does not necessarily keep up with facts on the ground. So
I just wanted to add that I actually called yesterday the museum in Clayton to see if they could fill me in on exactly when all this was happening, that they went to Trinidad, and they have a brand new director who doesn't know the answer to that question, and she'll let me know. But I went online to see if I could find some more information about the Hertzbergs, and surprisingly, surprisingly, it seems that Trinidad, the hospital in Trinidad, was the closest one to Clayton, at least for a while. And so there were actually several Hertzsteins that were born at the hospital there in Trinidad, and several of the Hertzsteins also died in the hospital in Trinidad.
This is Kim, just very briefly. One of our partners in this endeavor is the New Mexico Jewish Historical Society, and they put on an annual conference every year that focuses on sort of the regional history of Jews in the area, with lots of great sessions. And they also have access to resources and research materials that could be helpful for people who have ties to the region or are curious about it.
Okay. May I say something to dovetail into this? Ron and I have second and third cousins. My mother's first cousin was the manager of the Hertzstein store. And we used to go to Clayton and visit them when we were small boys. And in turn, they would come to Raton. And the Fritz and Doris Scheuer were Jews from Clayton, eventually moving to Santa Fe with their three sons, our distant cousins. But yes, the Hertzstein's store was quite an emporium in that area of northeastern New Mexico.
So, Sue, you there?
What, me?
Yes, you're up.
Oh, I didn't have a question. This is all wonderful. I love it, but no, I don't know.
Okay, well, nice to meet you. Sue grew up with my family. She reached out to me. So, well, it's nice to say hello to you in
this
person.
This is wonderful. I love it. I'm sorry. I heard you say Sue, and I thought, is there another Sue? Because, no, I don't have a question. But this is fantastic, and I can't wait to get out west and be able to check all this out, because it's fantastic.
Our doors are open to you.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
I have a question.
Is this Lori? Lori Copeland was going to be next.
Hi, this is Lori. I want to thank Randy and Ron and Dave and I'm sorry, the trigger.
Just write down that you're my
My great great uncles were some of the people who were involved in founding the temple, and my great grandparents were members of the temple. My grandmother attended Sunday school at the temple. My great parents were married at the temple. My husband and I traveled from Michigan, where I live now, out to Trinidad in 2016, saw the for sale sign, and were very upset that the temple was for sale. We were fortunate enough to have a neighbor woman who was able to let us into the building, so we had a chance to see it. And it is indeed beautiful. So hopefully you can continue the good work with the restoration. I have two questions, or one question and a comment. Sorry about the organ at the temple, and I don't know if it's true or not, so I don't know if any of you know the story of the organ.
We're hearing a little background noise.
I can say something about the organ. The organ that is there now was shipped from the East and installed in 1922. It's an ESTY, E-S-T-E-Y, isn't it? Correct me if I'm wrong.
Yes,
wrong. ESTY. And it still works. It's got a magnificent, majestic sound. It fills the space. It's got two keyboards as well as foot pedals. And it's something to behold when you hear it. There's gold pipes that go around the, yes, there it is. Those pipes are decorative. They are not sound producers. Although there's been rumors to the effect that they do that, they're just decorative because the inner workings are behind those pipes. And it's from 1922. It's quite a sound. And one of our older members, you might all get a kick out of this, was Albert Moses. His family came to the Trinidad area in the 1860s, 1870s. He played the organ, and Ron would remember this, till he was an older man. And when I say older, I'm talking about mid to late 80s. And he would sit at the organ, and you can see the two keyboards. And through no fault of his own, I guess you might say, there were blue notes played. But regardless of that, he was playing till he was, oh, I'd say 85 to 89. And Albert Moses was a fixture, you might say, playing the organ. It was something to watch him get up the stairs. There's three flights of stairs to the organ. And he struggled to get there, and he would play. And it was something. Those are direct relations to the founders of the synagogue. He was a son, born in probably the 1890s. Just a little bit of a side history.
And let me just play audio just for a moment.
Oh, good.
Hear the organ. I think you'll recognize the melody.
It's a little hard to hear.
Yeah, it's a little rough. But
we did get a taste of it.
Yeah. But it does work.
Leah, can I ask one other quick question?
Sure. And then just we'll conclude with one other question. I think it's Bialik. The Bialiks okay. have a question. So, and then we'll.
Okay. My other question was you said something about finding archival and for bringing archival information up from the basement. I know that there's a bunch of archival information in Cincinnati, having gone there. Yes. Year and plowed through a lot of it to see, do you have any more early, towards the beginning of the temple's history information still the temple, or is that all in Cincinnati?
We do have a lot of early information about the temple. We haven't gone through a lot of it because they are in boxes and they're dusty and they're dirty and we haven't gone through them. But we do have a lot of the early archives. And as you said, many have been sent to the Union of American Hebrew Congregations in Cincinnati. And that's where that's sort of a depository for us. And anything that has Jacob Rader Marcus's signatures, they want that always in Cincinnati. And we have a lot of his items in Trinidad as well. So we just haven't gone through a lot of it. But I think we have a lot of information from the early 1900s that we've discovered as well. And by the way, for the organ, there is an ST, is it ESTEY or ESPEY?
ESTEY.
ESTEY. That is a very, very well-respected, very old organ building company. This is a fine example of theirs. And they have a museum also for ST organs. That I bet they would love to know more about the one in Trinidad.
One other thing we found, in addition to all the dusty archives, upstairs by the organ, there was a leather pouch full of really old music that used to be played up there. You know, some of it was in German, some of it was in Hebrew, and some of it was in English.
Okay, so Bialik is... There you go.
Hi. I just had a question about the reception of Jews from Europe during World War II, especially the Polish consul was very active in sending Jews from Poland to Trinidad. And I'm wondering if there's any reference to that in the life of the congregation.
This is Randy. I've never heard that. I'm not disputing what you're saying. I'd never heard, that's an interesting sidebar. You say they were sent from Poland to Trinidad?
Right, you could get a transit visa that would have you end up in Trinidad.
I've not heard that. Have you ever heard that, Ron? Or
you're probably thinking of the Caribbean island of Trinidad.
Oh, you know what? I came in on this because my wife was listening, and I worked in Suriname.
This is Trinidad.com.
And I thought, of course they need to, wrong Trinidad, I'm sorry.
No, I must say that's been the best question of the day for me.
You're just trying to see if we're all still listening.
But you know what?
Thank you.
That is a valid question in the sense that, as far as we know, most of the German Jews who came to Trinidad probably came from New York through Ellis Island or Chicago. But we are trying to find out if there are people who came as part of what's called the Galveston movement, because there was a significant wave of Jewish people who came to the United States through Galveston, Texas. And we're trying to find out if there's any connection to Jews who arrived that way who may have come to Colorado.
There is.
So what I think I'm going to do is exit the full screen unless you guys need the PowerPoint still.
No.
Okay. I just want to see everybody's faces. Let's all thank the board for the time and the effort that they put into this. That was amazing. It was really, really great.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for inviting us to do it.
Thank you so much.
You know, I hope to make it in Trinidad at some point. If I do, I know I have six friends there to connect
with.
Yeah,
please let us know. Absolutely.
And all of us. We all have six friends. Great.
Thank you.
Well, with that said, we'll see you tomorrow in Detroit. I gave the wrong time and I really... Okay, so yes. Tomorrow, and then, 3 p.m. tomorrow, and then Friday's going to be Boston. And that's at 11 a.m. California time and 3 p.m. California time for tomorrow. All right. Take care, everybody. Enjoy the rest of your day.
Thank you.
Shalom. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom.